We are talking about artificial life and nature-inspired algorithms. So far, we talked about what is life, what is artificial life. Then I introduced you to basic concepts in optimization. And then we talked about simple optimization algorithms, local search, simulated annealing, taboo search. And then we spent quite a lot of time talking about evolutionary algorithms and various kinds of evolutionary algorithms. And now it's time for two examples of other biologically inspired optimization algorithms. I will be using a PDF script as usual, and the link to this script you have in the description of the video. Let's have a look at what we talked about so far. Artificial life, introduction to optimization, taboo search, simulated annealing, and local search algorithms. Then a large part on evolutionary algorithms, and now other nature-inspired optimization techniques, ant systems, ant colony optimization, and swarm intelligence, and then particle swarm optimization, and a few words about existing other similar optimization algorithms. I will start with particle swarm optimization. But when you look at those two names of sections, you see swarm intelligence here, and you see swarm optimization here, and even here you see swarm intelligent. So what it is about this swarm? Swarm is just a group of individuals, a group of agents, and what they do is usually, in this context, emergent. And this is what we want. This is what we are interested in. We are interested in some emergent property or emergent behavior of this swarm. And in particular, we are interested in optimization behavior, because this is what we are talking about now. We are talking about optimization algorithms. So in all those cases, we will be interested in some behavior that leads to the discovery of globally optimal, hopefully, or at least some interesting solution. Okay? And first we will start with particle swarm. I want to start with particle swarm because it will be easier for you to understand based on what you already know about evolutionary algorithms. Because particle swarm is quite similar. And I will also start with an example so it is easier for you to at least grasp this general idea of how this algorithm works, and then I will explain all the details. I will use a simple demonstration from this artificial life portal, so you can go to this page and click English. You will also have a link in the footnote in the script I will use. And you are probably familiar already with this simple application. So you select some optimization function, or you can write your own optimization function if you like. You select an algorithm, in this case particle swarm, because this is what I want to show you, and how this algorithm works. First, what is similar to evolutionary algorithms? You also have a population of individuals, a population of solutions, and in this case this is called the swarm. In evolutionary algorithms we talked about a population, now we talk about the swarm, but we know that it is just a set of solutions, okay? In mathematical terms, it's just a set. And as usually, you see those white dots, the population. And now, you do not have crossing over, so this is one difference compared to evolutionary algorithms, and you do not have mutation, and you do not have selection, but regarding mutation, you have something similar to mutation. You know, mutation in evolutionary algorithms was just a small change in each solution, in the genotype of each solution. In this case, we do not have mutation, but each particle, because we have particle swarm, so it's a swarm of particles, each particle is constantly moving in some direction. You can imagine these are birds, and those birds are flying. They are flying over the landscape, the optimization landscape. And the entire logic of this algorithm, it is all about changing velocity of those particles. Okay? So each particle has some direction of movement, some velocity vector, and this velocity vector is composed of three parts or three components. It's actually a weighted sum of three components. One component is its current velocity vector. So it's like an inertia. How much your velocity vector will change. And one component is it's the current vector. So nothing would change if you only considered this component of the velocity vector. But there are two more components. One is velocity towards the best known solution among all the other individuals in the swarm. So it's like accessing global knowledge from the entire swarm, global knowledge of the entire swarm, regarding who discovered the best solution so far and where it is. So it's the direction towards the best known solution for all those swarm participants, okay? Swarm individuals. And the third component of this weighted sum, this velocity vector, is the direction towards the best solution you found so far. You as the participant of this entire swarm. Your own private best known solution so far. Okay? So all those particles are moving in some direction, and you, as the user of this algorithm, you have to decide how much attention you pay or how much value you place for all those three components of the velocity vector. How much you want your velocity to stay as it was earlier, this is this inertia, how much you want to turn towards the best known solution in the entire swarm, and how much you want to turn towards your own private best discovered solution so far. This is it. Every participant in this swarm follows the same rules, follows the same formula. Okay? So we can run it very slowly, and you will see the entire swarm gathering near this location. This is, of course, an extremely simple optimization problem, just for illustration. We can speed it up. Okay. But now let's choose a more demanding optimization function. For example, this. And let's run this algorithm again. I will stop this just to show you that at the bottom you have those three components. Inertia, which is not changing current velocity of each solution. Initially, you can set this velocity to a random vector in this multidimensional space. The second component, or the second weight that you can adjust here, is aspiration for local optimum, which is going towards the best known solution discovered by each particle independently, their own private best solution found so far, and aspiration for global optimum, which I kind of criticized because it's not natural. When we would have any physical system, you wouldn't have this global communication. For example, if you imagine birds, each bird knows everything about itself, but it doesn't know what's the best location in the entire group of birds. But anyway, we do not have to be realistic in this case. We are anyway designing some engineering solution, so this is maybe some exception to this biological inspiration. And of course, you adjust the number of particles as well. So let's continue. And now, if I decrease the weight for this movement towards global optimum, you will see that those particles will no longer be interested in converging in this best location. Let's increase speed a little bit. And you can see that this system reached some kind of an equilibrium state, some stable state, nothing changes. But if we now increase the weight of this component, you will see that they will start moving towards the global optimum. Okay? So we can play a little bit with this demonstration to understand how it works. As I mentioned, you can even write your own formula or change this particular formula. Now let's read this short description in my script, and then I will also show you the details of this algorithm, how it actually works. So, particle swarm optimization, introduced in 1995. It is quite similar to evolutionary algorithms. A group, or a population, or a swarm, a set of solutions. Particles, they can be called particles because we have particle swarm, moves or flies. You can imagine birds in the space of solutions seeking better and better areas. There is no crossing over or mutation. Each particle remembers the best solution it has discovered so far and knows the best solution found by its neighbors or the entire swarm. So this is this unrealistic communication, but this would be much more realistic if each particle didn't have access to the best solution discovered by anybody in this swarm, but only by their neighbors. This maybe would be more biologically or naturally or physically realistic. The movement of it, and it would also work. The movement of each particle in each step depends on its speed, whose vector is changed in the direction of randomly weighted best remembered solutions. Best remembered meaning best locally, privately, and best globally in the entire swarm. Particle swarm optimization usually converges faster than evolutionary algorithms. This is simply a simpler algorithm, simpler in formulation, probably not as powerful, but still quite sufficient in many not so difficult optimization problems. Now let's have a look at the details. Here we have footnote 4, and footnote 4 is the description I will show you in a moment, and footnote 5 is exactly this educational demonstration I showed you already. So now let's look at this Wikipedia description, because this is where I want to show you a few things. First of all, this simple animation. It not only shows you the evolution of locations of the entire swarm, but also shows you those velocity vectors. This is why I wanted to show you, because this demonstration didn't show those velocity vectors. And this velocity is actually the key component of the entire logic of this optimization algorithm. So now let's look at the most important part. We have this algorithm described, and I will now explain each and every line. For each particle, I, from 1 to S, do initialize the particle's position with a uniformly distributed random vector. So XI will be a multidimensional location in this entire search space, and it is simply uniformly sampled. So each location is equally probable. This B low and B up could be like lower bound and upper bound of this space, of this search space. So we simply are randomly sampling with equal probability of every location. Okay? So we have our swarm distributed uniformly in the entire space. Initialize the particle's best known position to its initial position. Because remember, every particle, every solution, needed to remember its own private best location so far. And obviously, when we are starting this algorithm, the best known location is the current location. So we are setting PI, and remember, PI is this private best location. We are setting PI to the current location, obviously. And then for each particle, if fitness function of this current location is lower than fitness function of this global best location, G is the best known position of the entire swarm. By the way, it looks like an access to uninitialized variable because G was never initialized, at least in this pseudocode. So somebody should correct this pseudocode. But G can be like the worst possible solution, for example. Update the swarm's best known position. So the point of this condition, which is in this for loop when you iterate through all your solutions, is simply to set G to the best solution among all the solutions you have, right? And then you initialize the particle's velocity, and again you have U, which means this uniform distribution. U in this range, this actually means that all directions are equally possible in this search space, okay? It maybe is not so important, I mean, it can be scaled up to a constant how big this vector is or how long this vector is. It's all about a random direction in this entire space. So initially, each solution, each particle doesn't know where to go, so it goes somewhere, okay? And then this is the main loop, the most important part. While a termination criterion is not met, do the following. The termination criterion, since we are dealing with the algorithm that doesn't have a natural end, we need to somehow end this algorithm, terminate it, and usual ideas apply here. You remember from evolutionary algorithms, for example, from taboo search, from simulated annealing, you can simply use a number of iterations without improvement, without improving the best known, without improving this G. This would be our stopping condition. Like, for example, 100 steps without improving G would terminate this algorithm. And one more thing for you, a question for you. When you look at this part, and in particular in this line, is this a minimization example or a maximization example? Because you remember, when you optimize, you usually either minimize or maximize, and in many formulations, you need to assume, when you write down your formulation, you assume that you are describing it from the point of view of minimization or maximization. So which one is this? Let's pause and you tell me. I'm sure it was so easy that everybody answered correctly. Now, let's go on with explaining this main loop. While a termination criterion for each particle, and look, this is such a big loop, this loop. It concerns all the lines below. You iterate for all particles from 1 to s, exactly as you did here. For each dimension, okay, so this loop may be a little bit redundant because they chose to separate dimensions in this description, but you could as well describe it in a vector form, and then you wouldn't need to write separate equations for each dimension. But okay, maybe it's simpler. So let's think about separating dimensions. So you may have, for example, two-dimensional space. Like, for example, in this demonstration, you had one dimension and another dimension. So you had two dimensions. For each dimension, pick random numbers. RP and RG, again, uniform distribution. So equal probability of a random number from 0 to 1. Completely equal probability. I think even that in this tooltip we have a nice plot. So A and B, A and B, A is 0, B is 1. Okay? So we have those two random numbers, and then this line is the entire logic of this particle swarm optimization algorithm. It's the change in velocity of each particle in dimension d. So the velocity of particle I, because we are in this loop, in dimension d, because we are in this loop, it's a loop in a loop for all particles for all dimensions. So this new velocity is, this is actually the same thing. Vid equals Vid, or Vid becomes, let's say becomes, because this right side is the new value, so it's like this arrow is like a substitution. So Vid is the same as here, but here we have some omega. And omega is this inertia. This is what I mentioned earlier. We adjust it as users of this algorithm. If we set omega to 1, then the new velocity would become the old velocity plus something else. And what is something else? These are those three components I mentioned earlier. So this is the first component of this velocity vector, this is the second component of this velocity vector, and this is the third component of the velocity vector. So first is not changing anything in our current velocity, and we decide how much we want to not change our velocity, our current velocity. The second one is phi p, or phi p, multiplied by rp, and rp is this random number we have just selected. And this is this direction for particle I in dimension d to their own private best known solution. You remember p? P is this private best discovered so far solution by a given particle, by particle number I. And X is their current location. So this is where they decide how much they want to go in the direction of their best known privately discovered solution. And the last component is completely, as you compare this and this, it's almost the same. But instead of P, which is their private best known location, they now try to go towards G. G in dimension D, G is this globally, it's not global optimum, but it's global in the context of swarm. So the best solution the entire swarm discovered so far. Okay, and it's again the difference between the location of this global optimum or best known in the entire swarm solution in dimension D and the current location of this particle I in dimension d. And this is also multiplied by this random value rg, just selected here, and the parameter, because phi p and phi g are parameters that you as the user need to choose. Okay? And these are precisely those three parameters. Okay? So this is omega, this is phi p, and this is phi g. So if you choose, for example, 1 for omega, 0 here and 0 here, then there would be no optimization because each particle would fly all the time in the same direction. It would completely do not care about where this private best known solution is and this global best known solution is. If you, for example, set 0, 1, and 0, then this particle would tend towards their own private best-known location. And it would stop there, or it would circle around this location. So it would be like a local search. And if you choose 0, 0, 1, for example, then every solution would fly towards the best-known solution discovered by some particle, but at the same time, there would be very poor exploration of the entire space, right? Because everybody would be converging towards the best known solution. Maybe by accident, while they would be flying towards this location, they would discover some better globally best discovered solution by accident. But there would be not much of swarming and flying around and exploring new areas, okay? So you, as the user of this algorithm, need to adjust omega, phi p, and phi g. And that would be it. Then this line is simply updating the location, because remember, velocity is just velocity. It's like a change in the value of the solution, but we are interested in x's. X is a solution, so a location of each particle becomes this old value plus velocity multiplied by something. And if you remember physics, basic physics, it's like location, velocity. So what do you need to put here in physics for units to be fine in this equation? You multiply velocity by what? Obviously by time. And in this algorithm, they say LR, and LR, they explain that this is the learning rate. So it's a little bit unfortunate to use the term learning in this algorithm. Maybe it could be like an optimization rate, or some progress rate, or some step, time step, simulation step, something like this. Probably step would be a nice name, or step size would be a nice name here, okay? So, it's not so much of a learning in this algorithm, but we know that it has this meaning of time. So if this value will be large, because it's another parameter, you need to set this. If this value will be large, then those solutions will be moving quickly and those steps will be large, because this is like a jump from one solution to another solution. So this jump, or the size of this jump, will be large if you set LR to a large value. And if this LR will be a very small value, then those steps will be tiny. And the algorithm will work slowly, simply, because those movements will be small. Okay? And now those two lines are very simple, because they are all about updating those privately best discovered solutions for each particle, and also updating this globally best discovered solution by the entire swarm. And here again, the same question as I asked you, whether it's minimization or maximization. The answer is the same. Okay, so I think you understand this. You can read this if you have any doubts. You can also ask me in the comments of this video if anything is unclear in what I said so far. Remember to play a little bit with this algorithm using this simple demonstration. And now, since I think we talked about everything here in this description, converges faster than evolutionary algorithms, usually because it all depends on those omega and phi parameters and learning rate. So this step size or time. I think now we are ready to discuss another biologically inspired optimization algorithm. And this one I'm going to talk about is not so easy, because it's more different from evolutionary algorithms and particle swarm as well. It's this ant colony optimization algorithm. Now, why ants? And what is especially intriguing is that I will be explaining this ant colony optimization in the example of traveling salesperson problem, because you know this problem very, very well. It's all about finding the shortest route which visits all the cities once, the shortest cyclic route. And why I said that it is especially strange and intriguing, because ants, they are quite good at finding shortest paths, for example, from their nest to some interesting location where food is, for example, but at the same time, they are almost blind. They almost cannot see. So it is very strange and surprising why and how they are able to find shortest routes while being almost blind. And you have a nice Wikipedia page when this is shown. Sometimes those ants are able to find shortest routes in distances like 100 meters or even kilometers. So this is completely contradictory. How can they do this while being almost blind? And now I'm going to tell you how they do it. I will use for this another simple educational application from this webpage. So let's add a few cities. Let's imagine we are looking for the shortest route in this set of cities, okay? And you are an ant, and you are almost blind, and your task is to do this. So let's assume you start in some random city. Let's say this is your starting city. And you are always going to visit some other city from the set of cities unvisited so far. So you need to remember where you already were and which cities you visited so far. Okay, so you start with this city, and so far all other cities are unvisited. So we wonder, should I go here, or should I go here, and should I go here, or here, or here? But you are almost blind. So you see this city maybe okay. This city you can hardly see because it is far away. This city is also far away. This city is also far away. This city is maybe a little bit closer. So you see this city very clearly. This city is probably a little bit more difficult to see. And those three cities are so far away that you hardly see them. But you know that maybe there is some city in this direction. So this is your first clue when you are looking for the shortest route. You go more often and more likely to cities which are more accessible, which means closer. They are more visible. Okay? So you are more likely to go to this city. You are a little bit less likely to visit this city and even less likely to visit those cities. And let's assume this is your only policy. This is your only rule of behavior. Then you would go from this city here. And now you are only considering this, 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 and this. Probably these and these. Those two cities are in maybe similar distance. Maybe this is a little bit closer. But your decision is probabilistic. So you not always choose the closest city. You sometimes choose some other cities. So in this case, you could even go to this city, even though this probably is the most distant city, but the probability is low. So maybe you go here, then you again consider this, this, and this. Most probably you go here, then you consider this and this, and this is much closer, but since this is a random decision, you can go here, here, and then go back here. Okay? So this is what would happen if you only considered this visibility. But ants are smart. They do something else, even though they are almost blind. And what they do, this something else, is actually their key to this success of optimization. And this is how they discover shortest routes without seeing much, with being almost blind. So what they do is they follow pheromones, and they also leave pheromones in the environment. So they have some way of indirect communication. It's not like one ant says to another ant, you know, this path was quite good, go this way. No, they communicate through environment. So they leave some pheromone marks on the ground. And let's assume, for example, this ant went this way I showed you. After they complete, in our algorithm we will do it after this entire route is completed. But in nature, of course, they need to leave this pheromone while they are walking. So they leave some marks, and this is the second component to deciding which city to choose. So when I first told you that this ant starts from this location and considers this city and this city and this city and this and this, this was only one component in the policy of behavior. Another component will be the amount of pheromone they can sense in these sections, or in this path. And the more pheromone they can sense, the more likely they are to choose this path. Okay? And of course, initially, when there was no other ants in this environment, there is no pheromone anywhere. So since the amount of pheromone is equal everywhere, it is zero, this ant needs to only obey this rule of visibility. But once there is some pheromone in the environment, they have to somehow balance those two components. How much they want to follow this visibility rule, the closer the city is, the more likely I want to go there, and how much I want to follow this pheromone, which is in the environment. And I said that this is communication through environment, and it has a special name. It's called stigmergy. Stigmergy is communicating through environment, for example, by leaving some marks, some signs in the environment. And many species, many organisms do this. Humans do this as well, sometimes. So now, how do we decide how much pheromone to deposit in this environment? Once an ant completes their journey and comes back to this initial city, let's assume that they add some pheromone, and by add, I mean now our algorithm. We need to have some structure in our program, like a matrix, maybe. When we store the intensity of pheromones on each path between each pair of cities, because potentially all those connections between cities, every connection between two cities can be chosen by some ant. So we need to remember the amount of pheromone between each pair of cities. Initially zero. Once this ant completes their journey, we add some pheromone to those sections between cities. Those ant has chosen to use so far. Okay? And then we repeat this process again, starting from a random city, but this time, this second ant, of course we are not simulating ants in our algorithm, okay? It's like just a metaphor. So this second ant now has some pheromone already in the environment, and this second ant, again, let's assume it starts from this city, it decides, I want to go to this city, or maybe to this, or to this, or to this, or to this. But now this ant has some pheromone as well, as I mentioned, so it needs to balance those two components. It's of course more likely to visit this city and this city and maybe these, because these are the closest cities to their current location and all of them are unvisited. But at the same time, maybe there is some pheromone here, because from our earlier path of this earlier ant, maybe this earlier ant went this way. So if there is some pheromone here and no pheromone here and no pheromone here, this ant will likely choose this city and this section to move. Okay? So why it works? Because in time, the amount of pheromone on shorter routes will be higher. Even though no single ant knows or sees the entire picture, no single ant is able to comprehend the entire complexity of the problem, and each ant only obeys local rules, right? Because they only see those individual cities and know how much pheromone is on each path. Still, globally, they are likely to converge to the shortest route. And you may ask, okay, but how much pheromone needs to be deposited on a route when once an ant completes their journey? And usually, for efficiency of this algorithm, we deposit the more pheromone, the shorter the entire route was. This helps this algorithm. So for a long route, if some ant completes a route and it was a long route, the amount of pheromone we will add to each section is slightly lower than we would do this if this entire route was shorter. Then the amount of pheromone would be larger. You can think about it in terms of density. For example, you have some fixed amount of pheromone to deposit in the entire route. Like you have a small bottle of pheromone, okay? And if this route is longer, of course, when you use your bottle of the pheromone on the entire long route, the density will be lower, okay? Because you always use the entire bottle. And if your route is short and you use this bottle, then the density of the pheromone, which is the intensity of smell of the pheromone, will be higher. One more picture that may tell you or illustrate how it is supposed to work and why it works in nature. Imagine we have such a simple graph. Let's imagine we go from point A to point E. By the way, this picture is from this publication. So we go from A to E, and we can either go this route or we can go this route. And so far there is no pheromone at all. So when you are an ant, you go from A to B, and now you decide, should I go to C or to H? And the distance to C is, as you can see, only a half of the distance from B to H. So based on this visibility rule, you would go to C probably twice as likely as you would go to H. And then you must go from C to D and to E, okay? But if you are completely blind and you can't even see C and you can't even see H, then your decision would be 50-50. And you just have some route left, route right. You don't know where those paths lead, so you will just go with probability 50-50 to the left or to the right. Okay, so let's assume you are completely blind. So you go with equal probability here and here. But now, if you go between A and E, A and E, E and A, A and E, E and A all the time, if you go back and forth, and if you are, for example, like ants, you emit your pheromone when you are happy, and for example, A is your nest and E is your food source, then obviously, since this is a shorter route between A and E, you will be traveling quicker between A and E, and you will emit more pheromone because you are more happy because you found food in E, for example. So the amount of pheromone will become higher in those two edges only because the frequency of traveling between A and E is higher, and those ants are happy more often, so they emit more pheromone, okay? And initially, the number of ants on this left route and this right route will be more or less the same. But only after some time, the amount of pheromone will be higher here. And this is when we have this autocatalytic behavior or positive feedback, because when this amount of pheromone on this path will be higher, more and more ants will tend to choose this path. And when more and more ants will tend to choose this path, the amount of pheromone will be higher and higher and higher and higher and more, okay? So you have this autocatalytic behavior, meaning a positive feedback, and ultimately, probably most ants will choose this route, okay? Initially, you have the same number of ants choosing both routes, and after some time, you will have more and more ants choosing this shorter route, which doesn't mean that there will never be any ant going in this direction, in this left direction, because there always will be, since the decision is probabilistic, especially in nature as well, there always be some ants going in this not optimal route, okay? And this is actually quite beneficial, because somebody will always be checking whether maybe something changed here. Maybe they will discover some shorter route and they will emit more pheromone because they will be happy more often. And then all this entire communication will update and will change. And then we will go in this shorter route. Maybe something changed in the environment. For example, there was some river and then some tree fell down over the river, and then you can cross the river, which you weren't able before. So this works quite efficiently in nature. We can actually run this ANT algorithm simulation in this simple demonstration. And this solid black line is the shortest route as discovered by ANTs, so it doesn't have to be optimal. And those green lines illustrate the amount of pheromone on each path. Okay, and you can run it many times, you can even add more cities. And you see that in many cases, at least in this simple demonstration, the behavior is not optimal. But obviously, if we run this algorithm for a longer time, because it's like a very quick and simple demo, which is supposed to illustrate that it's not always optimal, but if we run it for longer, then especially for such a simple problem, it would always discover the optimal solution. So, this was a lot of explaining. Now let's read this entire text, which is in this section 4.1. ANT systems, ANT colony optimization, and swarm intelligence. The behavior of social insects in general, and of ANT colonies in particular, has since long time fascinated researchers in ethology and animal behavior, who have proposed many models to explain their capabilities. ANT algorithms have been proposed as a novel computational model that replaces the traditional emphasis on control, pre-programming, and centralization with designs featuring autonomy, emergence, and distributed functioning. These designs are proving flexible and robust. You remember this example of a tree falling and connecting two sides of a river? Able to adapt quickly to changing environments, falling tree, and to continue functioning even when individual elements fail. This is also important. Even if a single ant fails and makes some bad, improper decision, doesn't make the entire system to fail. Okay? It's not dangerous for individual components of the system to fail. Maybe it will mean that the entire behavior will be not so optimal, but still it's not so dangerous as it would be if we used some very precisely engineered and designed solution or some designed algorithm. So this is the advantage of all those biologically inspired algorithms. They are very robust against trying to break them in small ways. ANT algorithms are a part of swarm intelligence. A particularly successful research direction in ANT algorithms is known as ANT colony optimization, ACO. ACO has been applied successfully to a large number of difficult optimization problems like QAP, TSP, routing in telecommunication networks, scheduling problems. In ACO, the discrete optimization problem is mapped onto a graph called construction graph in such a way that feasible solutions to the original problem correspond to paths in the construction graph. Because so far, I explained this idea to you based on this traveling salesperson problem. Okay? And it was quite easy to understand when I showed you this, how this works. But you may ask, okay, but how about all those other optimization problems which have nothing to do with cities, visiting cities, looking for the shortest cyclic route and so on? How should I solve all those problems using ANT colony optimization? And the answer is that you need to think in a slightly more general terms and try to map your problem into this construction graph. And you no longer think about cities, that you go from city to city. You decompose your entire solution into some components, and then each component becomes a state, and an ANT chooses whether they want to build your solution from this component, or maybe from another component, or maybe from another component. So you can solve many problems different from TSP using ANT colony optimization. You just need to think in some more general terms. An ANT system, a particular ANT colony optimization algorithm, was introduced in 1992 and was inspired by the observation of the behavior of ant colonies, emergence. You remember we talked a lot about emergence in this initial lecture on artificial life, and I gave you a number of examples. Emergence of global properties following the mutual interaction among many elementary agents performing simple actions. The algorithm is easy to parallelize, okay, because we have individual ants, and they are completely independent, at least to some point, because there is this global pheromone information. But otherwise, it's easy to parallelize. How do ants find the shortest route between two points, being almost blind and having very simple individual capabilities? By pheromone deposition, each ant moves at random unless they feel the pheromone. Then they follow the marked path and leave new pheromone. The collective effect is a positive feedback. Two aspects are present, exploration and exploitation. As usually in every optimization algorithm, we have those two components. Exploration, meaning trying something else, and exploitation, meaning digging in places you already know they are good. So you are trying to discover more in good areas when you exploit. And an example of the optimization algorithm which is best at exploiting is local search. Okay? It's exploitation in its purest form. And exploration in its purest form is a random algorithm. Because a random algorithm doesn't care, completely doesn't care about what it discovered so far. It just tries random solutions one after another, completely independently from everything that happened so far. So a random algorithm is a perfect explorer, and a local search is a perfect exploiter. Pheromone is simulated by a global knowledge structure, which is updated by ants. This knowledge is used in the construction of solutions during the iterative optimization process. And now this line is just a simple explanation for you so you do not get lost in all those terms. We have swarm intelligence, and it's like a general group of approaches when we have a swarm of solutions and they interact somehow and there is some global behavior, some emergent behavior. Then we have ant algorithms as a special case of swarm intelligence algorithms. And then we have ant colony optimization, which is again a special case of ant algorithms, and then we have some specific implementations we will not even talk about now in details because they differ only slightly in the logic of the algorithm, and they are all a specific example of, or each of them is a specific example of ant colony optimization. Applying ant system to solve TSP. At any given time, each city has a certain number of ants which choose another unvisited city with a probability that is a function of distance. Distance is this visibility, or actually distance is the inverse of visibility to that city. The smaller, the higher the probability, and the amount of pheromone between the cities. The higher the probability. Mm-hmm. And I said here that each city has a certain number of ants, but we do not need to simulate this in our algorithm. I told you that in our algorithm, of course, we do not simulate ants at all. Because when you strip the logic of this algorithm, of this biological meaning, then you only have some structure in the memory of your computer, and you do not have ants, you only are deciding which path to choose or which part of a solution to add to your current solution. So of course there are no ants. Don't think you simulate ants in the implementation of this algorithm. And of course you do not need to have like 100 ants, even though in the formulation of the algorithm you have some loop, but there is no such thing as an ant in your algorithm. And those two terms in bold are important, because these are those two components taken into account by each ant when they decide which city to visit, which next city to visit, or which part of a solution to add to the current solution. There are several mechanisms for modifying the amount of pheromone: ant density, ant quantity, and ant cycle. I told you that the simplest approach would be to deposit pheromone once an ant completes their journey, and the amount of pheromone would be proportional to how short this entire route is. So the shorter the route, the more pheromone you deposit on each section in this route. You remember this example with a bottle with a constant amount of pheromone. An example of applying ANT system to solve a problem that does not resemble TSP, the attribute selection problem. For example, cities are attributes and paths are subsets of attributes. Cities are attributes and paths are subsets of attributes. How strange! So this is this mapping of some other problem to this construction graph that was mentioned, I think, here. Okay? This only shows that you do not always need to think about cities and routes and cycles and TSP. You need to think in a more general way in order to apply this optimization algorithm to any optimization problem. In this approach, we do not have to visit all the cities. Okay, so this is contradictory to TSP, a big difference. And their order does not matter. So it's another huge difference when compared to TSP. But this idea will still work, this idea of applying ANT to solve the optimization problem. So in general, instead of speaking about the distance to some city, we speak about the attractiveness of adding some part of a solution. Okay? So obviously, in this example, I told you that in general, those red points are not cities, but parts of the solution. And you just decide how you want to compose the entire solution. This is what ANT decide upon. Some parameters of ANT colony optimization: number of ANTs, pheromone persistence, pheromone importance. One thing I didn't tell you about is that this pheromone, while being deposited by ANTs, also evaporates, because we need to somehow be able to forget this old information. Because those initial decisions of ANTs may be far from optimal. Those decisions that were made when there was no pheromone at all in the environment. So we need to forget about old information, and information is pheromone, so this pheromone evaporates slowly. Okay? So we are updating this structure with new, this pheromone structure with new information all the time. You can read again about emergence if you didn't already. You can read about stigmerge. This is this communication through environment. And now I want to tell you about this single most important equation in this ANT colony optimization algorithm. Here is a general loop of this algorithm, not so interesting. And here is this single equation I want to focus on. The probability of choosing this XY section, so this moving to the city Y from city X, so this is some section between X and Y in this construction graph for this algorithm, for ANT K is equal to, and you have tau XY to the power of alpha and eta XY to the power of beta. Tau XY and eta XY. Alpha, beta, and some denominator which looks complicated. But when you look at this denominator, you see that you have exactly the same thing as in the denominator. Tau and eta, but you have some sum. And the role of this denominator is only to normalize this value so that we have probability, and you know that probability needs to be in the range from 0 to 1, and all probabilities must sum to 1. So we can safely ignore this denominator, and then we will not have probability, but some value proportional to probability. The higher the better. The higher this value, the higher the probability would be. So it's only for normalization. So let's focus on the denominator. We have tau and eta. So tau is simply the amount of pheromone. this is what you keep in your matrix between all the cities. You have this pheromone that all ants emitted earlier or deposited earlier. And ETA is the attractiveness. I mentioned that those cities are visible. The farther the city, the less probable it is that an ant will choose this city. So usually this ETA, as mentioned here, this ETA is the inverse of the distance. Because this ETA is attractiveness. So the farther the city, the less attractive it is. And those alpha and beta are parameters. And again, it is up to you to choose those parameters as the user of this algorithm. And this way you balance the influence of the pheromone and the influence of this local information, which city is the closest city. Okay? So you balance the influence of this global information left by other ants, pheromone, tau, and this private information of each ant, which city to choose based on the city you are currently in. Okay? In some variants of the algorithm, there is no beta. Beta is assumed to be 1, so you only have alpha, only one parameter. And I think this is okay. This is what is mentioned here. Alpha is the pheromone importance. So we assume that beta is, for example, 1. Okay? So this was the key equation or the most important equation of this algorithm. It captures the idea and the logic of this algorithm. So we talked about particle swarm optimization. Then I told you about ant colony optimization. And now we have the third section, other swarm intelligent optimization algorithms. And I only want you to read this list. This list is only a part of a larger list that you can read about on Wikipedia. And as you can see, there are many algorithms based on this metaphor of biologically inspired optimization and swarm intelligence. And there is even a joke that every researcher wants to propose their own algorithm. This is why I mentioned here that some animals are still unused. So probably many other similar algorithms will be proposed. But when you learn about them one by one, you realize that they are quite similar. And I mentioned here that these algorithms are all about the exploration versus exploitation trade-off. Because this is a question what they do with their time, with the CPU cycles. They need to decide whether they want to explore more or exploit more. And in every algorithm, you usually have some parameters when you decide whether you want to exploit more or explore more. So these are those alpha, beta, or you remember omega, phi p, phi g in this particle swarm algorithm. So in all algorithms, you have those parameters to choose between exploration, which is this randomly discovering new areas, and exploitation, which is this local search-like approach, when you are optimizing intensely in some neighborhood, for example, or in some places when you know there is something interesting to discover, or you hope there is something interesting to discover. Okay, you have two testing questions, but as usually you can come up with many other questions. And this completes our list of examples of biologically inspired optimization algorithms. So see you in the next lecture.